If you didn't record a session yourself, to mix the session, you'll often have to import audio stems into your Logic project from another recording engineer. This is just the first thing you'll have to do. Often there'll be audio stems that were recorded in Pro Tools, and they typically come in one of two ways. The first is what I refer to as bar 1, beat 1 stems. This means that the stems always start at bar 1, beat 1 of the session, regardless of when the actual instrument or voice recording comes in. For example, this reversed cymbal crash here is the only thing on this track, but there's like 40 some odd measures of silence on the track before it comes in. However, this silence has been left in the audio file on purpose to make sure that it syncs up in the right spot. So the downside is that the overall file size of all the stems is larger, but the advantage is that you don't have to worry about the session syncing up. This way, all of the tracks will always sync up properly. So in this video, we'll assume that this is how the stems were given to us, and in the next video, I'll go over another scenario where the stems are not in sync. So here's a new empty Logic project. Logic forces us to create at least one track, so I'll do that. But there's some things I need to check before importing my audio. First, I need to check that the sample rate of the project matches the sample rate of the stems. If you right-click on one of your audio stem files and select Get Info, you'll see the stem sample rate and bit depth here. So in my Logic project, I'll go to File, Project Settings, Audio, and from here I can select the starting sample rate of my project and all imported audio and new recordings. In short, sample rate affects the frequency range of audio recordings. In musical projects, I find that in particular the high-end and mid-high-end is brighter and clearer the higher that your sample rate is set. But if you get stems that were recorded at 44.1 kHz, there's not really much of a point in going higher because you can't improve the quality of a 44.1 file by importing it into a session at 88.2, for example. Now take that statement with a grain of salt because at a higher sample rate, your audio effects plugins will operate at a higher sample rate, which in some cases can result in higher quality processing, again, particularly in the high frequencies, but it's almost negligible. So traditionally, 44.1, 88.2, and 176.4 were traditionally used for audio projects, and 48, 96, and 192 were traditionally used for video projects. However, that's kind of a blurred standard nowadays. Personally, I record everything at 48 kHz, which includes this project. That's because it's one step higher in quality than 44.1, and it's low enough that I don't waste a bunch of hard drive space when recording. Keep in mind that 96K is twice the file size as 48K, and 192 is 4 times that of 48. So normally I'd select 48K here, but I have one more thing I want to show you later, so I'm going to keep this on 44.1 kHz. You'll also notice that some of these are in italics. This means that my current audio engine or audio interface cannot record at these sample rates. This will vary from device to device. Next, I'll go to Logic Pro 10, Preferences, Audio. Here we can change our I/O buffer size. I/O buffer has to do with how information is processed and the latencies that are involved with that processing. With lower buffer sizes like 32 or 64 samples, you get less latency, which is good for recording because you don't hear a slapback delay in your headphones while recording. But it's bad for mixing because lower buffer sizes can't handle heavier loads of plugins. So for mixing, I typically max out the I/O buffer size to 1024 to make sure I can carry the heaviest plugin load without the session crashing. If we go to the Recording tab, you'll see that you can select a 24-bit recording. If you deselect this, all new recordings will be made at 16-bit. I always keep this at 24-bit, even though we aren't going to be making any new recordings in this session, just mixing. In short, bit depth controls the dynamic range of audio recordings. People confuse this for being able to get a louder audio recording. That's just not true. It's really the opposite. The bit depth determines how low the noise floor is in the recording. At 16-bit, the noise floor is around negative 96 dB, which means you have a dynamic range of around 96 dB between noise and peak volume. With 24-bit, it's 144 decibels. Think of the noise floor kind of like tape hiss. They're two different things, but all recorded sound on a physical or digital medium has inherent noise in it. It's just a matter of how far down that noise is. So let's go with the better option of 24-bit. Lastly, I'm going to change my tempo to 128 BPM, since that is the recorded tempo of the stems I'm importing. If you're lucky enough to get bar 1, beat 1 stems, you can change the tempo after importing without any sync issues. However, this is not true with the scenario I'll show you in the next video. So I'll just pull up my folder with all of my audio stems. I'll hit Command A to select all and drag and drop them into Logic. I'll keep the Create New Tracks selection and press OK. Notice that Logic recognizes that these stems don't match the project's sample rate of 44.1 kHz. This is why I left the sample rate at 44.1 earlier to show you that this dialog pops up. You can choose to convert the files to the session sample rate or change the session sample rate to accommodate the file's sample rate. I'll change the session sample rate to 48K to accommodate the files. If I had selected 48K for my sample rate earlier, this dialog would not have appeared. All right, let's see if everything plays back okay.
There are sharks in the water. There are snakes in the grass. You are one of those people in your castle of wire. You can tell me you're sorry. Extend an olive branch.
Yep, I skipped through the song a bit and it sounds like everything is in sync. The last thing to do here is just save our session by pressing Command S. I'll give the session a name and you can choose between saving it as a package or a folder. A package is a single file with all files incorporated into it. I find using a folder is a better option because it allows me to go inside the folder and explore the audio files inside if need be. So I usually use this option. You can also choose which files to copy into your project. Always check the audio files box. The others are not so important here because we're not really dealing with software instruments in this mix. However, I will check the EXS instruments box because there's a situation later on where we'll use the EXS24 sampler for drum replacement. We'll get to that much later in the course. Then I'll hit save and I'm all set. In the next video, I'll show you how to import files that do not have a bar 1, beat 1 silence on the front end of each region.